love.
Continuing on page 4 of your bulletin, Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And we have our Gloria, our song of praise, sung by more than one voice. And if you didn't get your recording into Andy this week, you can still do it next week. And join the chorus, join the group of voices singing this these pieces of music together, our service music. Household, the church, in your steadfast faith and love, that through your grace we may proclaim your truth with boldness and minister your justice with compassion, for the sake of our Savior Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus, Chapter 19, verses 2 through 8. They traveled from Rephidim, came into the Sinai desert, and set up camp there. Israel camped there in front of the mountain while Moses went up to God. The Lord called to him from the mountain, "This is what you should say to Jacob's household and declare to the Israelites. You saw what I did to the Egyptians and how I lifted you up on eagle's wings and brought you to me. So now, if you faithfully obey me and stay true to my covenant, you will be my most precious possession out of all peoples, since the whole world belongs to me. You will be a kingdom of priests for me and a holy nation. These are the words that you should say to the Israelites." So Moses came down, called together the people's elders, and set before them all these words that the Lord had commanded him. The people all responded with one voice, "Everything that the Lord has said, we will do." Moses reported to the Lord what the people said. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. You're on, Tina. Would you unmute?
I know, but my computer just took a dump. So it's Psalm 63.
Psalm 100.
It's Psalm 100. What, how far?
The whole thing, which is just four verses.
Oh, okay. Sorry, Pastor. It's... Okay, I got it. Psalm 100, a psalm of thanksgiving. Shout with joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him, singing with joy. Acknowledge that the Lord is good, is God. He made us, and we are his. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving. Go into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and praise his name. For the Lord is good. His unfailing love continues forever, and his faithfulness continues to each generation. The word of the Lord.
This is a reading from Romans. Therefore, since we have been made righteous through his faithfulness, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. We have access by faith unto this grace in which we stand through him, and we boast in the hope of God's glory. But not only that, we even take pride in our problems because we know that trouble produces endurance. Endurance produces character. Character produces hope. This hope doesn't put us to shame because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. While we were still weak, at the right moment, Christ died for ungodly people. It is not often that someone will die for a righteous person, though maybe someone might dare to die for a good person. But God shows his love for us, because while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading today is from Matthew, in which Jesus sends out the 12 disciples to minister in. It is known as the missionary discourse, the Holy Gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, according to Matthew. Jesus traveled among all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, announcing the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and every sickness. Now, when Jesus saw the crowds, he had compassion for them because they were troubled and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The size of the harvest is bigger than you can imagine, but there are few workers. Therefore, plead with the Lord of the harvest to send out workers for his harvest. He called his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to throw them out and to heal every disease and every sickness. Here are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, Philip and Bartholomew, Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector, James, the son of Alphaeus, and Thaddeus, Simon the Canaanite, and Judas, who betrayed Jesus. Jesus sent these 12 out and commanded them, "Don't go among the Gentiles or into a Samaritan city. Go instead to the lost sheep, the people of Israel. As you go, make this announcement: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cleanse those with skin diseases, and throw out demons. You received without having to pay. Therefore, give without demanding payment. Workers deserve to be fed, so don't gather gold or silver or copper coins for your money belts to take on your trips. Don't take a backpack for the road, or two shirts, or sandals, or a walking stick. Whatever city or village you go into, find somebody in it who is worthy, and stay there until you go on your way. When you go into a house, say, 'Peace.' If the house is worthy, give it your blessing of peace. But if the house isn't worthy, take back your blessing. If anyone refuses to welcome you or listen to your words, shake the dust off your feet as you leave that house or city. I assure you that it will be more bearable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on Judgment Day than it will be for that city. Look, I am sending you as sheep among wolves. Therefore, be wise as snakes and innocent as doves. Watch out for people, because they will hand you over to councils, and they will beat you in their synagogues. They will haul you in front of governors and even kings because of me, so that you may give your testimony to them and to the Gentiles. Whenever they hand you over, don't worry about how to speak or what you will say, because what you can say will be given to you at that moment. You aren't doing the talking, but the Spirit of my Father is doing the talking through you. Brothers and sisters will hand each over to be executed. A father will turn his child in. Children will defy their parents and have them executed. Everyone will hate you on account of my name. But whoever stands firm until the end will be saved. Whenever they harass you in one city, escape to the next. Because I assure you that you will not go through all the cities of Israel before the human one comes." The Gospel of the Lord.
Good morning. I'm wearing my St. John's stole today. I think probably there's only one of you that will recognize working on it. It was given to me in 1977. but I still enjoy it and I'm glad to wear it today. Our first lesson comes from fairly early in the Exodus. The people are at the very beginning of the transition from becoming the band of runaway slaves to becoming a people and a nation. It may not have been exactly 3 months, as the scripture said, but it's about that time. And there are a few things that have happened. The water from the rock, the complaints about the food and the giving of the quails and the manna. But a lot of things are yet to come, including the golden calf and the serpents. The people are now camped at the base of the mountain where Moses encountered the Lord in the burning bush. Moses goes up on the mountain and speaks with the Lord, and God tells Moses, "Thus you shall say to the house of Jacob and tell the Israelites, you've seen what I did to the Egyptians and how I bore you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, therefore, if you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples. Indeed, the whole earth is mine, but you shall be for me a priestly kingdom and a holy nation." Moses reported what the Lord had told him, and the people all answered as one, "Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do." These must have been very exciting times. They had seen their pursuers foiled by a miracle at the Red Sea. They'd been given food and drink as needed, like a miracle, and they'd come to this new place. I'm sure their hopes were very high, and they were not thinking of the challenges of passing through the desert and winning the homeland. "If you obey my voice and keep my covenant, you shall be my treasured possession out of all the peoples." It was easy to agree. It would have been hard to even think of how hard it might be. "Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do." That's a lot easier to say than to do. Today we're in the middle of a great pandemic, and we're struggling to figure out what's safe to do and what's necessary to do, even physically. If that weren't enough, we also find ourselves once again confronted by a grim reminder of the systemic racism in our nation, in our national makeup, and demonstrations of many people calling for change. And I'm sure some of us are saying, yes, now's the time for real change, and we mean it. But after a little while, maybe little or nothing will really change. And I'm sure also some of us are saying, if I just shelter in place and stop watching the TV news, I'll feel a lot better. Everything the Lord has spoken, we will do, or will we? When Jesus sent his disciples out on their missionary journey, he sent them with nothing and told them to accept the hospitality they were given. He told them not to take anything with them to take care of themselves, no gold or silver or copper, but to receive what was given. We don't know what the disciples experienced. I suspect in some places they got bread and water and little more. And in others, they were well fed and perhaps even overfed. The important thing is that Jesus told the disciples, "Proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons." He didn't tell them to be safe. He didn't tell them to fix society. He told them, "Proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near." What does it mean for the kingdom of heaven to have come near? What is the good news that we ought to proclaim? Paul writes, "Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand." The good news is about peace with God. It's about grace. The Christian faith isn't just one more thing we need to do. It isn't about learning the liturgy or singing hymns. It isn't even about doing good works. We do all those things because we are at peace with God through the grace in which we stand. We're Christians because Christ was willing to die for us. We're Christians because we are loved in spite of our selfishness and pettiness and our failure to follow through. The problem in the proclamation is that a lot of the people we know just don't recognize the good news for what they need. They don't recognize the fact that they have a huge God-shaped hole in their lives. They don't know that they're not at peace with God. They don't know that they need God's love. We can't convince others that they need God. We can't convince others that Christ is the answer. What we can do is go out of our way to make them welcome in our lives and in our church. We need to invite our friends and neighbors to things in the church we think they might enjoy. When we again have concerts, dinners, speakers, Christmas pageants, and other events going on, we can invite others. When they've been to a couple of events and discovered that we're pretty normal people, they might even be open to trying a worship service. The people who camped at the mountain heard what Moses told them, and they answered, "Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do." We know they didn't do it very well. The truth is, we don't do it very well either. But God loves us anyway. It may be that the death of George Floyd will result in less racism in our land, and it may not. But God loves us anyway, and Black lives have always mattered to God. The Lord Jesus sent out his disciples without gold, silver, copper, a bag, a tunic, a staff, or extra sandals. The same Lord calls us to reach out to the world around us. We know we should be doing this. Everything that the Lord has spoken, we will do. Of course we will. We will because God loves us. I say this to you today in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Now let us affirm the faith of the Church in the words of the Nicene Creed, beginning on page 11 of your bulletin. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. For the prayers of the people, when John pauses and leaves silence, I ask that you would leave prayers in the chat feature of Zoom. So if you don't know where that is, at the bottom of your screen where you see the controls for mute, unmute, participants, all those things, you'll see a little chat bubble that says chat. And if you just click on that, you'll be able to type in whatever you'd like to pray for after each one of the petitions. We have a new set of prayers of the people this week that are written for us by Deborah Spencer.
I ask your prayers for this parish and for all churches in the world. For Justin, Archbishop of Canterbury, for Michael, our presiding bishop, and for Lucinda, our bishop. May we all be inspired with visions and dreams. May we be servants of grace. Pray for all who know the Lord. I ask your prayers for those who have chosen to lead our cities, states, and nations, especially Gavin, our governor, and Donald, our president. Whatever their beliefs, may they be ever renewed by the Holy Spirit. Pray for our leaders. I ask your prayers for unity and peace, that we may examine our own actions and learn from the wrong we do. May we remember we all speak the same languages. Pray for justice and peace. I ask your prayers for those who are sick or injured, especially those with COVID-19. May Christ comfort and heal them, turning their suffering into hope, their fear into strength. Pray for the well-being of all. I ask your prayers for those who are hungry, oppressed, disadvantaged, shunned, or in prison. May we find ways to increase our compassion, especially towards those different from us. Let us be willing to change our ideas of enough so that all may have enough. Pray for compassion. I ask your prayers for firefighters, healthcare workers, peaceful demonstrators, police, soldiers, and all who put themselves in harm's way for our sake. May they treat all those they help with the same love and skill. Pray for those who protect life and liberty. I ask your prayers for the planet, for the earth that God created, for the ground he prepares and waters, for the sheltering rock. May we be wheat, not weeds. May we renew the face of the earth. Pray for our home world. I ask your prayers for those who have died and for those who live and miss them. As children of God, may we all be heirs of life forever in him. Pray for the departed.
Sorry, I was muted. Let's try that again. O Lord our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people and the multitude of your mercies. Look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Continuing with the confession, if we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God. God of mercy, justice, reconciliation, and peace, we confess to you that we are unmerciful, unjust, and have often settled for a false sense of peace to avoid confrontation. We have sinned against you as individuals in our actions and inaction, our words and our silence, and our thoughts and beliefs. We have sinned against you as a community, a society, and a culture that embraces racial bias, white supremacy, and hierarchical norms instead of your ways and your kingdom. Reveal to us the truth of our past and communities, the ways we have hurt each other, and the ways that we ignored the voices of the hurting. Make clear to us the areas where we have been complicit or have participated in the oppression of those who bear your image. We silence the stories that make us uncomfortable or challenge our viewpoint and ignore the people who tell them. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. We do not love all people equally, but prioritize those who are like us, agree with us, and make us feel good about ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that together we may delight in your will and walk in your ways.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Since we're just on Zoom today, if you want to unmute and say peace.
Peace, everybody.
Peace, everybody.
Peace, God's peace.
Peace to the Lord.
Peace, Mother.
Ellie and Michael, is Sasha nearby?
Sasha is not nearby.
Oh, hi.
Sasha's the dog, for those of you who don't know. Tina has a lot of animal companions that she loves.
Yeah.
Okay. So if you have a birthday or an anniversary or you're traveling this week, if you would, you can unmute and tell us that since we're just on Zoom. I know Jeannie is traveling. You want to tell us, Jeannie, where you're going?
Yes, I get to go to Alaska to meet my grandson, Sully. He will be 2 months old while I'm there. And I'm very excited.
Oh, cool.
Yay.
Have fun.
Yes, have fun and be safe on the travel and the plane and all that.
Yeah, that's the most dangerous part of it. And Alaska requires that you get a COVID test before you go. So I've got that scheduled for Tuesday.
Okay. Wow. All right. Well, if you have your prayer book, anybody else traveling? If not, let's go ahead and say the traveler's prayer for Jeannie.
Along with having a birthday, Vicki is traveling or has been this weekend.
Vicki? Oh, okay. Yes. Vicki Wilson is traveling as well. Okay. So so we'll pray for Jeannie and Vicki for travelers. And if you have your prayer book, it's at the top of page 831. If you don't have your prayer book, hopefully you have it memorized. Otherwise, you can just listen. Sorry. I should really start printing the traveler's prayer in here too for the bulletin. All right, traveler's prayer, top of page 831 in your prayer book. And we're praying for Jeannie and Vicki. Let us pray. O God, our Heavenly Father, whose glory fills the whole creation and whose presence we find wherever we go, preserve those who travel, in particular Jeannie and Vicki. Surround them with your loving care. Protect them from every danger and bring them in safety to their journey's end. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Birthdays. We want to give thanks for the safe birth of Miles Spencer Damon, who is Deborah and Jim's new grandson. So we let me just say a special prayer for Miles. Gracious God, we give you thanks for Miles and his new life in this world, and we pray that you would surround him with your grace, give him an inquiring and discerning heart to know you and to come to love you. And we pray for his parents and his grandparents as they surround him with your love, and pray that he may grow in wisdom and strength all the days of his life. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
All right, so we have birthdays. We have Elizabeth Guest, who is one of our folks at Dominican Oaks, and Vicky's birthday as well. And I see in the chat feature here, we also have somebody sent something way back up here.
Donald Trump.
Yeah, Donald so I've got John and Olivia, who is the Duncan's son and granddaughter. So John, Olivia, and then I also see his President Trump's birthday. So we'll add Donald. And any other birthdays? I'm trying to scroll through the things here. Okay, so we'll have for the birthdays, Elizabeth, Vicki, John, Olivia, and Donald. Let us pray. Watch over Elizabeth, Vicki, John, Olivia, and Donald, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may your peace, which passes understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Okay, baptism anniversaries, and I see we have a few other things in the chat that we want to pray for, but anyone know of any other baptism anniversaries? We've got Deborah and Malou. Nope, okay. So we'll say the baptism anniversary prayer for Deborah and Malou. Let us pray. Almighty God, through baptism, you unite us to the death and resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, and commission us for ministry in his name. As your servants, Deborah and Malou, celebrate the anniversaries of their baptisms, give them courage, patience, and vision, and strengthen them in their Christian vocation of witness to the world and of service to others, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we have Elizabeth Rowan's husband, Carlos, starts a new professorship tomorrow. So we'll say a prayer for Carlos. Gracious God, we give you thanks for Carlos and for his new position. We pray that you would surround him as he begins this new job and be with all of the work he does and the students he is with, particularly during this time of online and virtual learning, that you would help them to form bonds and connections even through cyberspace. We pray for continued success and for the connections and learning that they will all have together. In Christ's name we pray, amen. And then it is also Flag Day today. So I've got, let's see, I know there's several things in the prayer book for our nation. Let's see. So prayers for our national life, if you would like to join in on page 820 of your prayer book. There's a really rather long one for our country, but let's go ahead and say this prayer for our country, number 18, which is at the top of page 820 in your prayer book. And if you don't have it, you can just listen. And this is in Write One language, so there you go. Almighty God, who has given us this good land for our heritage, we humbly beseech thee that we may always prove ourselves a people mindful of thy favor and glad to do thy will. Bless our land with honorable industry, sound learning, and pure manners. Save us from violence, discord, and confusion, from pride and arrogance, and from every evil way. Defend our liberties and fashion into one united people the multitudes brought hither out of many kindreds and tongues. Endue with the spirit of wisdom those to whom in thy name we entrust the authority of government, that there may be justice and peace at home, and that through obedience to thy law we may show forth thy praise among the nations of the earth. In the time of prosperity, fill our hearts with thankfulness, and in the day of trouble, suffer not our trust in thee to fail. All which we ask through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Yeah. Okay, now I usually say a word of welcome to visitors, but I can pretty much tell now that we're only on Zoom that everybody who's here has been here before, so I'll save you the spiel. Let's see here. Okay, here we go. Look, I have a special thing for visitors now that we aren't live today. But anyway, offertory. Moving on to the offertory. This time, we offer our gifts to God. And we invite you during the offertory solo to make a financial gift using the online donation form or to document the hours of your time. You'll see that on your screen there with a link to where you can do that. And today's offertory solo is written and performed by Peter Goodman, our own Peter. So as you listen to this, remember the words of Jesus who said, "Take care, be on your guard against all kinds of greed, for one's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions."
Sustain me, O Lord. Sustain me, O Lord. Sustain me, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Give me an inquiring discerning heart, the courage to will and to persevere, a spirit to know and to love you, and the gift of joy and wonder in all your works. Sustain me, O Lord. sustain me, O Lord. Sustain me, O Lord, in your Holy Spirit. Love, joy, peace, and kindness, goodness and faithfulness. These are the gifts you give to me, and they're all I need as I find my way. Sustain me, O Lord. Sustain me, O Lord. Sustain.
Thank you, Peter. And he was on the call earlier. I don't see him still here. But anyway, thank you, Peter. And now we sing together our presentation hymn, Take My Life and Let It Be Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. And remember that if you did not send in your audio of yourself singing for this recording, you can still do that this week and join the voices on this recording. Communion, we start by saying together Psalm 63, a psalm of longing for God's presence. O God, you are my God. Eagerly I seek you. My soul thirsts for you, and my flesh faints for you, as in a barren and dry land where there is no water. Therefore
I have gazed upon you in your holy place, that I might behold your power and your glory. For your loving kindness is better than life itself.
My lips
shall give you praise.
So will I bless you as long as I live, and lift up my hands in your name.
My soul is content
as with marrow and fatness, and my mouth praises you with joyful lips. And I remember you upon my bed, and meditate on you in the night watches. For you have been my helper, and under the shadow of your wings I will rejoice. My soul clings to you,
Your right hand holds me fast.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we now pray. Say together the prayer for spiritual communion. We can try that out, as some folks were saying the Psalm 63 with me. We do it at 8 o'clock every week, and it's a small enough crowd. Hopefully we won't overload ourselves. So let us say together the prayer for spiritual communion as we remember that the Eucharist is being celebrated somewhere all the time, and that it's always available to us on the spiritual plane, and that we can unite ourselves with Christ in that sacrament anytime and any place. As we say this prayer together. In union,
O Lord, with the faithful of your church, where the Holy Eucharist is now being celebrated, we desire to offer you praise and thanksgiving. We present to you our souls and bodies with the earnest wish that we may always be united to you. And since we cannot now receive you sacramentally, we beseech you to come spiritually into our hearts. We unite ourselves with you and embrace you with all the love of our souls. Let nothing ever separate you from us. May we live in you and may you live in us in this life and in the life to come. Amen.
Amen.
You see why we don't normally do that, but hey, it's nice just to hear each other's voices sometimes. And you probably want to mute as we sing together on Eagle's Wings.
My rock.
I noticed Allie is playing her flute, and I wondered, Allie, if you'd be willing to unmute and play the refrain through for us once on the flute so we can hear you.
No, I would not be willing.
Okay, all right, that's fine. All right, we'll continue together with the general thanksgiving at the top of page 22 of your bulletin. And if you want to unmute, you can to say it together, or otherwise just say it along. Almighty God, Father of all mercies,
we your unworthy servants.
Give you humble thanks. For all your loving kindness, loving us, and to all whom you have made. Bless you for our creation,
creation, and all the blessings of this life.
Above all, your immeasurable love, redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means and for the hope of glory. We pray, Lord, give us such an awareness of our sins, that with this truth, not only with our lips, but in our lives, walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days.
For Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives with you in the Holy Spirit,
Be honor and glory throughout all ages. Amen.
May God bless you with discomfort, with easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships, so that you will live from deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, abuse, and exploitation of people, so that you will work for justice, equality, and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer from pain, rejection, starvation, and war, so that you will reach out your hand to comfort them and to change their pain into joy. May God bless you with the foolishness to think you can make a difference in this world, so that you will do the things which others tell you cannot be done. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen.
We will go out with joy in the Spirit. We will go out with God. We will go out with joy in the Spirit.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen.
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 Amen. Amen.